एंड ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस इवेंट. डियर स्टूडेंट, अमिडस्ट ऑफ दिस पैंडमिक वेयर योर कॉलेजेस आर क्लोज एंड नाउ यू विल बी फेसिंग योर यूनिवर्सिटी एग्जाम, यू ऑल मस्ट बी वरीड एंड एंशियस. बट माई एडवाइस इज टू अवॉइड द ऑल डिस्टर्बेंसेज अराउंड एंड सेट योर प्रायोरिटीज राइट. यू नीड टू बी फोकस्ड एट दिस टाइम एंड दिस रैपिड रिविजन विल हेल्प यू टू गेट बैक ऑन राइट ट्रैक. So today we'll be starting with the revision of general anatomy in four consecutive sessions, out of which I'll be covering the head, neck, face and related osteology. My aim is to give you the gist of HNF and make you understand the general outline of HNF. We'll be doing this by discussing important topics which are exam oriented, and in this process you'll also learn how to write the SAQs and LAQs. Let me make one thing clear. When I say exam oriented, that doesn't mean that these are the questions will be coming to your university exam. This is just the important topic from dental point of view, whose knowledge is very crucial for you. So let's dissect HNF, not in a literal sense here, but we have studied HNF by dividing it into many subtopics. Like we have studied triangles and regions. We have studied the muscle, nerves, vessels, some glands, joint, and other important topics. So one by one, we'll see how we are going to revise these topics. So we'll start with triangles and regions. Why such division is necessary? This is just for the ease of understanding and to bring about a universal pattern for better understanding of everyone. Although all the triangles are important, among which carotid and posterior triangle is of very importance. In the region, infratemporal and submandibular region are also very important from exam point of view. Coming to the triangle, we'll see how we are going to write down a question on the triangle. Whenever I am teaching in a classroom, I ask my student to correlate a classroom to that of a triangle. See, the classroom has got boundaries or it has got walls. You can name it like anterior wall, posterior wall, medial wall, and lateral wall. Similarly, your triangle has got boundaries which are named in a similar fashion. Then the classroom has got roof and floor, very much similar to a triangle. Now when we are in the classroom, student and teacher, we are the content of the classroom. Similarly, triangles also has contents in the form of nerves and vessels. Your answer to the triangle would be incomplete if you do not mention about the applied importance. Though it is asked or not, you make sure that you write one or two lines on the applied anatomy of whatever topic is there you are writing about. And of course, draw as many diagrams as possible. Without diagrams, the answers are again incomplete. If you look at your answer as compared to your write-up, there has to be more and more diagrams. So we'll see how posterior triangle can be described by using this method. So see, the sternocleidomastoid, this is the first muscle that you all study. Sternocleidomastoid divides the neck region into anterior part and posterior part. If we talk about posterior triangle, it is a triangle present between sternocleidomastoid. So it has got anterior boundary, posterior boundary. The apex, which is superiorly placed, is the where these two muscles are meeting, while base is inferiorly placed, which is formed by the middle one-third of the clavicle. Coming to the roof. Now, this is for all triangles. The roof is almost always is formed by skin, superficial fascia, and deep fascia. If you remember, in this order only you have dissected the triangles to reach to the content of the triangle. Okay. Now, the superficial fascia contains fat and it contains vessels and nerve that are going to supply the overlying skin. Okay. So, in this case, the superficial fascia contains these four cutaneous nerves, as you can see. These are the four cutaneous nerves from the cervical plexus. Again, there is one vein, which is called as external jugular vein, is also found into the roof of the posterior triangle, and one very important muscle, that is platysma. And finally, deep fascia is forming the third layer, and here it is the investing layer of deep cervical fascia, which is forming the roof. What about the floor? Again, in general, floor is always formed by the muscles. Here there are four muscles which is forming the floor for the posterior triangle. Now these muscles, they come under the group of prevertebral muscles and they are covered by a fascia called as prevertebral fascia. Now because of this muscle, if you can identify, this is the inferior Bailey of omohyoid, divides the posterior triangle into larger occipital triangle and a smaller supraclavicular triangle. So when the question of writing down the contents comes, you are supposed to write contents for both of these triangles separately. So as you can see here, most of the contents are mainly the nerves. So you are supposed to enumerate the nerves that are present into the occipital triangle. The spinal accessory nerve is very important content of the occipital triangle. Do not forget to mention about this nerve. Then there are cutaneous branches of the cervical plexus. Before they become cutaneous, they are lying deep into the content of the occipital triangle. Okay. And there is one artery that is present called a superficial cervical artery. And occasionally you'll see occipital artery also in the content of occipital triangle. What about the supraclavicular triangle? Nerves, there are trunks of the brachial plexus and the branches of trunks of brachial plexuses are found in the supraclavicular triangle. Then there is one artery and one vein. We are well versed with them. And those are subclavian artery and subclavian vein that is found into the supraclavicular triangle. As I told you already, without the diagram part, your answer will be incomplete. So how are you supposed to draw the diagram? If you compare between these two diagrams, this diagram, the one which is labeled, is more self-explanatory. So you should be drawing the diagrams which are more self-explanatory, which are properly labeled. The anterior, posterior, superior, inferior, everything has to be labeled. And those diagrams should be anatomically correct. So that is how you need to practice for the diagram. And make sure that you'll be mentioning about the applied importance of posterior triangle. You can read about branchial cyst and branchial fistula to write down about the applied anatomy of posterior triangle. Similarly, we can discuss about the regions also. So region has got the headings like we discuss it under boundaries, content, and applied importance. So take into consideration of infratemporal fossa, very, very important, because all your life you're going to work in this region only. So where exactly this infratemporal fossa is situated? If you keep your finger medial to the ramus of mandible, your finger is inside the infratemporal fossa. Just to give you an idea where this fossa is exactly located. If we see the boundaries in detail, make it a point that whenever you are studying about boundaries, skull and mandible should be there with you. Unless and until you see the structure on the skull, it is very difficult for you to understand also and to remember it also. So just don't go on mugging up the thing. Try and correlate it on the dry skull as well. So boundaries, anteriorly, as you can see, this is the maxilla. Posteriorly, you'll get the styloid process. Laterally, this is the ramus of mandible. Medially, as you can see here, this is the lateral pterygoid plate. The roof is formed by the greater wing of the sphenoid. Floor is open and it is continuous with the parapharyngeal space below. Content. I've told you already, the contents are already always nerves and vessels. And to add the list, lymph nodes and lymphatic. But here in infratemporal fossa, along with nerves and vessels, we are getting two important muscles as well. So what is the content? It contains muscles, lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid, which are the muscles of mastication. Nerves, mandibular nerve and all its branches, corda tympani and otic ganglion. In the vessels, vessel means artery and vein. Always remember this. So you are getting maxillary artery and pterygoid venous plexus in the infratemporal fossa. This is the diagram you should practice, which shows you content of infratemporal fossa. Also, if a question comes on lateral pterygoid muscle, the same diagram you will be drawing to show the relations of lateral pterygoid muscle. So it is very empirical for you to know about this diagram, where lateral pterygoid is seen, deep to that medial pterygoid is seen, and you can see the branches of mandibular nerve between the lateral pterygoid and medial pterygoid. Of course, this artery that is seen here is the maxillary artery. Coming to the joints. Okay, so these are the general points under which you are supposed to describe a joint. So first point will always be how you're going to classify the joint. Secondly, what are the bones that are forming the joint? Thirdly, the ligaments that are holding the bones in position to form a joint. Fourth thing, what are the movements that are occurring in the joint and the muscles that are producing those movements. And finally, as always, applied anatomy. Coming to the temporomandibular joint, extremely important. You might get a long note on TMJ or a short note, or you get MCQs on the temporomandibular joint. So how this joint is formed? As the name itself is self-explanatory, it is a joint between temporal bone and mandible. To be more specific, it is a joint between mandibular fossa of the temporal bone and condyle of the ramus of mandible. So that is how the joint is formed. How we are going to classify? You can see these 4 points that I have written here. So one by one, we'll see why they are called like that. So it is a bicondylar variety, obviously, because condyle of the ramus of mandible is articulating with the mandibular fossa. But you can see only one condyle here. So why it is called a bicondylar joint? Because you cannot move one TMJ at a time. Can you move just the right TMJ? When you are trying to move right TMJ, your left TMJ is also moving. Means both these temporomandibular joints act as a unit. So it is called as bicondylar joint. Then this is a complex variety of joint. Why it is complex? Because the joint cavity is divided by fibrocartilage or an articular disc. That is why it is called as complex variety. Then it is an atypical variety of synovial joint. Why? Normally or typically, the joint surfaces, the articular surfaces are lined by hyaline cartilage. But in case of temporomandibular joint, the surfaces are lined by fibrocartilage. You need to remember this. That is why this is an atypical variety of synovial type of joint. Now, why synovial? Because the joint cavity is filled with synovial fluid. This is easy. See, depending upon what cementing material is there between the two articular processes, we are going to classify the joint. If the cementing material is fibrous, then that is a fibrous joint. If it is a cartilage, then that is a cartilaginous joint. If it is the synovial fluid, then that joint is synovial variety of the joint. So all these 4 points should be there into the classification of TMJ. What are the movements and mechanism? So movements are, three types of movements are occurring, protraction and retraction, depression, elevation, and side-to-side movement. Bringing about these movements, basically two mechanisms are involved. One is called as gliding movement and the second one is rotation. If you try to move forward the mandible, like in protraction, if you are moving it forward, you can sense that the mandibular head or the condyle is gliding forward over the fossa. So protraction and retraction takes place because of this gliding mechanism. But when you are moving the mandible up and down, it is actually, we are rotating the condyle under the mandibular fossa. So these two types of mechanism are involved in the movements of the TMJ. Now, whenever we are talking about rotatory movement, that rotation has to occur along an axis. So you have to mention about the axis around which this rotatory movement is taking place. Like the most important one is this transverse axis, which is passing through the neck of the mandible. Around this transverse axis, the elevation and depression movement is taking place. While the sagittal and the vertical axis will bring about the side-to-side movement or combination of elevation, depression, and side-to-side movement in chewing. So these three axes are very important to describe the movement around the TMJ. What are the muscles? You can make a chart like this and you can write the muscle producing the movement. Means you can write down a movement and in front of that, you can write down about the muscles that are producing the movement. I want to add one thing here. All the four muscles of mastication, that is lateral pterygoid, medial pterygoid, temporalis, and masseter. Okay. Among this, except lateral pterygoid, all the rest three are the muscle which are acting anti-gravity. If you remember the mandible and if you remember the attachments of all these four muscles, you come to know that except lateral pterygoid, all three muscles produces ridges onto the mandible. Not only that, temporalis forms the coronoid process, that is actually a traction epiphysis formed because of the pull of the muscle. But how is the insertion of lateral pterygoid? It is in the form of a fovea. So all three are anti-gravity except lateral pterygoid, which is working in line with the gravity. So it brings about the depression. Okay, and then you can add about the applied anatomy of the TMJ. Lockjaw is very commonest thing. So you can write down about the lockjaw condition of the TMJ. Coming to the nerves. If a question on nerves comes, how you are going to write it? So we'll describe the nerve as from where it is originating, what is the course of the nerve before it terminates, what are the branches that are given, and finally, what is the supply. For example, we'll be learning about the facial nerve. We'll see origin of the facial nerve, branches, and finally the applied importance. Now, as you all are aware that your facial nerve is a mixed nerve, means it contains motor fiber and it contains the sensory fiber. Motor fibers are going to supply the muscles of facial expression, right? Because it is the muscle, it is the nerve for the second branchial arch, which gives rise to the muscles of facial expression. So facial nerve is going to supply to the muscles of facial expression. It is also a secretomotor nerve, means which brings about secretion to the salivary gland, submandibular and sublingual through the submandibular ganglion. It also brings about secretion through the lacrimal gland through pterygopalatine ganglion. So two motor routes, one supplying to the muscle, other supplying to the gland. What about the sensory route? It is going to carry the taste sensations from anterior two-thirds of the tongue, right? And it also carries general sensation around your ear. So all these four fibers are originating from these nuclei that are situated into the brainstem. So motor nucleus is situated into the pons. It also gets the fibers from superior salivatory nucleus. It receives the fibers from nucleus of tractus solitarius and spinal nucleus of trigeminal. This is about the deep origin, which is actually present inside the substance of the brainstem. Now, once the nerve receives the contribution from all these four nuclei, it runs forward and emerges, as you can see here, between emerges at the pontomedullary junction just above the olive. You can see a larger motor root and a smaller sensory root. Now, as soon as it emerges, this facial nerve, you can see here, enters through the internal acoustic meatus into the petrous part of temporal bone. It traverses around in the middle ear cavity. It takes its course through the middle ear cavity and then exits out through the stylomastoid foramen. So the nerve has got an intracranial course and an extracranial course. Now, the stylomastoid foramen is situated between the styloid and mastoid. Always give attention to the terminology or the nomenclature that is used. They are usually self-explanatory. So the name stylomastoid means the foramen has to be present between the styloid and the mastoid process. Now, once the nerve emerges from the stylomastoid foramen, it runs forward and enters the substance of parotid gland through posteromedial surface. Now, that nerve runs through the substance of the parotid gland where it gives off five branches, and those five branches emerges through the anterior border of the parotid gland. And those will supply to the muscles of facial expression. Now, this diagram is very helpful, which shows you all the branches of the facial nerve in a schematic way. So you can practice the diagram to show the branches of the facial nerve. You can see greater petrosal nerve from the genu, nerve to stapedius, corda tympani nerve given just before the nerve exits through the stylomastoid foramen. Once the nerve exits through the stylomastoid foramen, it is going to supply the motor supply to the muscles. Now, we all know what this pathology is. This is actually the Bell's palsy, which is intranuclear paralysis of the facial nerve. This is a right-sided facial palsy. How do we diagnose? If we see the wrinkles on the forehead are lost on the right side, you can see the wrinkles on the left side. Patient is unable to close its eyes by because orbicularis oris is paralyzed, so patient is not able to close its eyes properly. Then this furrow, the nasolabial furrow, is lost, and when the patient is trying to smile, the angle of the mouth is deviated to the affected side. So these are the features of the Bell's palsy. But Bell's palsy is usually self-limited and it recovers on its own. Complete recovery occurs in Bell's palsy. Other than facial nerve, mandibular nerve, extremely important. You should know in and out about the mandibular nerve, from where it is arising, how it is dividing into two divisions, the anterior and posterior, and branches from anterior division, branches from the posterior division. You must know this. It should be on your tip of the tongue. Then glossopharyngeal nerve is also very important, and ansa cervicalis. If time permits, please read about the hypoglossal and vagus nerve. Coming to the vessels, I have already told you, whenever we are saying vessels, that means we are meaning arteries and veins. If a question comes on blood supply of something, you are supposed to write down about the arterial supply and venous drainage. Just do not write only the arterial supply. When the question is blood supply, mention both arterial supply and venous drainage as well. So how we are describing an artery, we'll see from where it is originating, we'll see its course, we'll see what are the branches it is giving in its course, finally what it is supplying, and how the artery is ending, what is the mode of termination, whether it is ending as an end artery or it is dividing into terminal branches or it is anastomosing with some other artery. There is one more mode of termination where an artery becomes continuous with some other artery, like subclavian artery continues as axillary artery once it passes the first rib. So for example, external carotid artery, what is the origin? It is originating as, or it is a terminal branch of common carotid artery at the level of thyroid lamina. If I ask you about the vertebral level, you should be able to tell that the vertebral level is the intervertebral disc between C3 and C4. That is the level at which external carotid artery is arising from the common carotid artery. What is the course of that artery? Now, after the origin from at the level of thyroid lamina, the artery runs upward, enter into the parotid, and just behind the neck of the mandible, the artery divides into two terminal branches. So how external carotid artery is ending? By dividing into two terminal branches. What are the branches of external carotid artery? It gives 8 branches, okay? So one should be well versed with this 8 branches, and you should be able to draw at least a schematic diagram to show the branches, okay? You can group it as anterior group, medial, lateral, and terminal. Very commonly, enumerate the branches of external carotid artery. A question comes like this. So do not haphazardly write down the branches like you're writing first superficial temporal, then lingual, then facial. Please don't do this. You have to go sequentially till the superficial temporal artery. One more tricky thing here is, if you're writing down a question on carotid triangle, there also you're supposed to mention the branches of external carotid artery. But again, do not mention all the 8 branches. There are just the first 5 branches of external carotid artery are there, which are given into the carotid triangle. So don't mention all 8. There are just 5 branches seen in carotid triangle. Coming to the veins. Now, veins are usually formed. So we'll see how the veins are formed. What is the course? Instead of branches, vein has got tributaries. Then what are the areas the vein is draining and how the vein is terminating? So these are the headings under which we will be studying the veins. These two very important veins, you must know about them. One is retromandibular vein, other is external jugular vein. If you prepare a question on retromandibular vein, you'll cover 3 questions. Retromandibular vein is required to be written in a question of parotid gland. You can write it when a question on blood supply of scalp is asked, or a question on blood supply of face is used. So these three questions will be covered if you know in and out about the retromandibular vein. Now, how this vein is formed, as you can see here, the retromandibular vein is formed by the joining of superficial temporal vein with the maxillary vein. Then a retromandibular vein is formed. Name itself suggests this vein is lying behind the mandible. That's why it's called as retromandibular. Now, in the substance of the parotid only near the apex, the vein is going to divide into posterior and anterior division. This is very unique for the vein. Veins usually do not divide. They receive the tributaries. They do not divide. But retromandibular vein has got this unique feature where it divides into anterior division and posterior division. You can go on explaining further that this anterior division joins with the facial vein and forms common facial vein, which in turn is draining into the internal jugular vein. While the posterior auricular vein is joining with the posterior division and forms external jugular vein. Now, this external jugular vein is running into the roof of the posterior triangle. If you all remember, it is running across the sternocleidomastoid and 2.5 centimeter just above the clavicle. It pierces the deep fascia and enters into the subclavian vein or drains into the subclavian vein. Okay. Very interesting topic, and that is muscles. So we all know under what heading we describe muscle. So we tell about the origin, insertion, nerve supply, and action of those of that particular muscle. If question comes on a particular muscle, you're supposed to write down about relations also. So I have taken an example of sternocleidomastoid muscle. Again, the first and foremost muscle that you are exposed in the dissection hall. So again, name is self-explanatory, sternocleidomastoid. So origin is from sternum and clavicle. Insertion is into the mastoid process. Now this origin and insertion, those terminologies are interchangeable. So it is not fixed. This is the origin or this is the insertion. The terminology is interchangeable. What is the nerve supply? Spinal accessory nerve. And what is the action? Now, this is a common question. What happens when single muscle is contracted? What happens when both the muscles are contracted? When a single muscle is contracted, as you can see here, the head is pulled to the same side while the chin is moved to the opposite side. Okay, so that is the action of a single sternocleidomastoid muscle. What happens when both the muscles are contracting? If the muscle is acting from below, means this is fixed, and this end is contracting. This is acting as an insertion. That time, the head is extended at atlanto-occipital joint. So what will happen? Your head is pushed forward. The idea is to maintain a horizontal gaze when you are peeping over a crowd. Imagine yourself into the dissection hall. So when you are standing behind your colleague, you peep forward. You try to maintain a horizontal gaze, and at that time, both of your sternocleidomastoid muscles contract. When the muscle is acting from above, means this is moving, the lower end is moving, it acts as an accessory muscle of respiration. So mention all these three actions in the sternocleidomastoid, just not the single muscle that is contracting. So mention all these three actions of sternocleidomastoid. Other important muscle, on each and every one, you'll get a short note. Lateral pterygoid, muscles of mastication and its nerve supply, muscles of eyeball, nerve supply, muscles of palate, muscles of larynx, and muscles of tongue are asked along with their nerve supply. And there is some interesting point about the nerve supply of these groups of muscles. Like all the muscles of soft palate are supplied by cranial accessory nerve except tensor veli palatini, which is supplied by the mandibular nerve. All the muscles of tongue are supplied by hypoglossal except palatoglossus, supplied by vago accessory, because palatoglossus is also coming under the muscles of soft palate. All the muscles of larynx are supplied by recurrent laryngeal nerve except cricothyroid, which is supplied by external laryngeal nerve. So remember these general lines. They are helpful for your theory, and they are obviously helpful for your practical vivas. We are coming to the end of our session now. We'll see glands, how we are going to describe the glands. So first and foremost, we should know about the location, where exactly the gland is located. what is the gross anatomy and relation of that gland, histology for that gland, development, blood supply, nerve supply, and applied anatomy. Try and read in this sequence only so that you won't miss out on anything. You'll cover everything on the gland. So here a case scenario we'll discuss. A 5-year-old girl comes to your clinic with her parents with the complaint of swelling over her cheek. You can see that the child is very tearful. That means the swelling is painful and the child is febrile, having high-grade fever also. So what is the likely diagnosis? To know the diagnosis, you should be aware of the region from where the swelling is arising. And you should know why the swelling is painful. So for that, we'll see now the parotid gland. Before the start, we'll see location of the parotid gland. So if you see this area between the mandible and the mastoid process, this area, here lies your parotid gland. So it is described by calling it as parotid region. So what are the boundaries? You can see here in front, it is the posterior border of the ramus of mandible. Behind, the mastoid process and the muscle that is attached to the mastoid, and that is sternocleidomastoid. Above, you can see the external acoustic meatus. Can you see above? It is limited by the external acoustic meatus. Okay. Below, it is limited by the muscle called as stylohyoid or posterior belly of the digastric. Medially, the structure that is present is this, the styloid process and the muscle attached to it. So that is the parotid region in which parotid gland is lying. Grossly, the parotid gland is pyramidal in shape, but it is an inverted pyramid. Means instead of apex pointing up, the parotid has got its apex pointing down. So it's an inverted pyramid. And apart from the main mass of the parotid gland, it shows many processes as well. Coming to the covering, every gland is covered by a capsule. Okay, so one is a true capsule and other is a false capsule. True capsule is formed by the condensation of fibrous stroma. And false capsule is formed by the deep fascia that is present around that gland. Here, this deep fascia is investing layer of the deep cervical fascia. This false capsule or this investing layer of deep cervical fascia merges with the masseteric fascia and it forms something called as parotidomasseteric fascia. Because of this fascia, the swelling in the parotid gland becomes painful because this fascia is unyielding in nature, means it is not giving space for the swelling to enlarge. So that's why the swelling in the parotid gland becomes very painful. Now, I would like to mention of one ligament here called a stylomandibular ligament. This ligament is present between the angle of the mandible and the styloid process, and it is actually the condensation of this investing layer of deep cervical fascia. What is the surgical importance of this ligament? As you can see in this diagram, the submandibular gland and parotid gland are very closely placed with each other. If a surgeon is working on either of these glands, he must be sure that he is working only on the gland he wants to work on. Okay, so what the surgeon does, he identifies the stylomandibular ligament first. So whatever gland is present above that ligament is the parotid, and the gland that is present below the ligament is the submandibular gland. So stylomandibular ligament has got a great surgical importance. We'll see the presenting part now. I have told you it is an inverted pyramidal shaped gland. So it has got an apex pointing downward. See, it is a base coming in relation with the zygomatic arch. Then there are surfaces. The surface that you see as soon as you open up the skin is the superficial surface. The surface that is in relation with this masseter muscle, can you see here? So that surface is anteromedial surface. And the surface coming in relation with the styloid process is the posteromedial surface. Talking about the borders, this is the